Yeah, thanks. I have I think about maybe 17 slides, so I'm hoping I can get through this in time. I know it's going to be a bit tight, but I do want to take just a moment and just mention that what I'm going to talk about today is a new phase for northern spotted owl population monitoring. This is the way that we're monitoring northern spotted owl populations range wide, and this includes a large part of the population in Washington. I want to acknowledge my co-authors for this talk. You'll notice there's a few Park Service employees that have been really involved in this transition and passive acoustic monitoring in general. I especially want to point out Scott Grimmel, the Olympic National Park, and Scott actually he has distinguished of being one of the first to ever do any work with passive acoustics in northern spotted owl. And he was really blazing trails. And this goes back to prior to my time with the Forest Service. I started here in 2015, and Scott, for several years, had been doing some acoustics work for northern spotted owl. So, yeah, I really appreciate Scott. And some of our first meetings and talking about acoustics was learning from Scott and what he was finding on the Olympic Peninsula. And also point out former Park Service employee Tara Chestnut, Roger Christofferson. He's up in North Cascades, and a couple other former folks in Mount Rainier, Stephen Mitchell and Dylan Fournier. So anyway, I just want to shout out to these folks. And you know, this is part of an interagency monitoring program to inform effectiveness of the Northwest Forest Plan. Of course, this involves the national park and the units that fall within the northern spotted owls range. So I'm gonna see if this works. Okay, so just some background, just make sure we're all on the same understanding. Northern spotted owl, some of the basic natural history for northern spotted owls is really important, and not only why we're so focused on northern spotted owls, but also what, you know, the ways in which we're monitoring these populations. So they're a territorial, non-migratory, medium-sized owl. They have high mate fidelity, also really high sight fidelity. They're this an obligate of old forests, so nesting, roosting, and they require old forest. This is a photo of a northern spotted owl actually from the Olympic Peninsula. And they're a case-selected species, kind of quintessential, long lifespan, low fecundity, fairly high survival. And the population that we're interested in is the northern spotted owl. You can see in this map here, kind of shows the general range and includes the Pacific Northwest. So this association with old growth forests has put the management and conservation of northern spotted owls in direct conflict with human interests, economic interests, particularly with the interest for harvesting old growth forests. And this goes back well over a century, human interest in harvesting these old growth forests. And there was this wholesale liquidation throughout much of the 19th century, or the 20th century, harvesting old growth forests. And it was we found that it was a causing population declines in northern spotted owls. And this set this up for what was kind of known in the 1980s and early 1990s as the timber wars. This is my predecessor here, Eric Forsman, and a lot of the work that he had done in the 70s and 80s really laid the groundwork in understanding the basic biology of northern spotted owls, but also the threat that this wholesale liquidation of old growth forests was having for northern spotted owls. And if you're interested in some of the history of this timber wars, I highly recommend this podcast that was put on by OPB. That's several episodes, and it just does, I think they've done a really nice job with kind of laying out the history and the implications of the Northwest Forest Plan and just what how those timber wars played out. So so we have now decades of science, conservation, and this conflict. In 1990, spotted owls were listed as threatened under the Northwest or the Endangered Species Act. This led to, there's a lot of details here, but in 1994, the Northwest Forest Plan was signed and began implemented. Northern spotted owls continued to decline, and then in 2020, the Fish and Wildlife Service made a decision that spotted owls, they warranted uplisting to endangered due to continued population declines. So under the Northwest Forest Plan, there's a mandate for monitoring. There's various modules of monitoring requirements under the Northwest Forest Plan. And one of them is monitoring northern spotted owl populations. And it was sort of laid out in this monitoring plan that there would be two phases. The first phase would be focused on demography on 8 study areas. And then the idea is that you would infer those results that you would find on those 8 study areas to the total population. I put the boxes here on 3 of those study areas in Washington. And these are showing the proportion of the initial population. So the dashed line there is the initial population. And you can see every one of these study areas, including those in Washington, we have a decline in the population. So we see this consistently. Some of the slopes differ and some of the timing of the declines differ, but we end up in the same place where we see pretty substantial population declines range-wide. And the plan also called for phase 2 monitoring. And this would be, the hope was, is that if there's association with habitat and spotted owl population status and trends in habitat, and then if populations then follow trends in habitat, that we could use just a monitoring of the habitat to be able to understand what's happening with spotted owl populations. But it turns out there's this disconnect, and I'll kind of get into some of that for various reasons, that the trajectory of habitat or forests that are used by spotted owls is disconnected with the population performance of spotted owls. And so any of this phase 2 transition, we would need to then couple that with range-wide occupancy rates. So this would sort of shift away from demography and more focused on population size and distribution, along coupled with habitat monitoring. So the two primary causes for spotted owl declines are loss of old forest, so that the forest that they require. And this happens through timber harvest, continues wildfires, but also invasive barred owls. And I imagine everybody is very familiar with the issues with invasive barred owls. These are this is another figure from the last meta-analysis. It was published in 2021. I have red boxes here showing the 3 study areas in Washington. And what this is, these are occupancy rates for spotted owls. Those are shown in the purple lines, and then barred owl occupancy rates are shown in the yellow. And you can see we have this really consistent relationship, declines of spotted owls and an increase in populations of barred owls shown here through occupancy rates. So we think about this potential transition to phase 2 in this context that we've got a barred owl issue, we've got declining populations, and the part of the challenge in phase 1, it's a single species focused monitoring program. And so it was really limited in ability to understand what's happening with barred owl populations. So when we're thinking about potential alternatives transition to different methods for monitoring spotted owl populations, we thought about bioacoustics. And we wanted to understand, one, what would be the detectability of both spotted owls, barred owls, how effective could bioacoustics be? And then the other question was, well, could we use acoustics, totally passive methods, to monitor trends in spotted owl populations? These were totally unknown just several years ago. So why would we consider passive acoustics? And you may hear this as passive acoustic monitoring or bioacoustics. Well, there's a lot of pros to this, why we would even consider this. One, it's passive, so these are just recordings. So anything that's making noise in the forest, wherever you're doing your surveys, you can learn about. So it's effective for multiple species. It's shown in lots of different studies that it's effective for rare species. It is totally non-invasive. These are just hanging on trees and they're just recording. So you're not changing the behavior or requiring to capture any animals or anything like that. We can cover a larger area with fewer crew. Long-term, we found it's more cost-effective and safer. This was a big one, that it doesn't require any night work compared to the demography work, and it's only daytime work. I'm already at 2 minutes. Oh my gosh. There's 2 minutes remaining. Okay, I'll move fast. So yeah, there are, you know, challenges, big data, a lot of startup costs, and require a lot of complex machine learning. So a student, Layla Dukach, what she found is that acoustics one could be really effective for high detection probability of spotted owls and barred owls at multiple different scales. And also we use this to inform our design to how do we most effectively sample a 5 square kilometer hexagon. We also add this other question is, could we use it to understand trends in spotted owl populations? So we did this through a simulation and we had lots of different scenarios, and I'll just cut to the chase here. What we found is that one, yeah, we could use passive acoustic monitoring to detect trends in spotted owl populations. And what we found is that the most effective design was what we call the 2+20% design. These areas shown in this red ellipses are where we have overlap. So we've done work with passive acoustics at the same time for at least 2 years. We're also doing the traditional methods of demography. So we have this overlap, and this is really important in any potential transition. And then by 2023, we had a complete transition, a fully transitioned to passive acoustics for monitoring northern spotted owl populations. A really big part of our ability to be able to do this is machine learning. We mentioned this early on. We knew that big data was going to be a challenge. And the only way we could do this, be able to basically teach machines to be able to help us process these data. This year, in 2023, we collected over 2.2 million hours of sound. I don't know how many years that is or how many people it would take to listen to that, but it's really mind-blowing. And so we use supercomputers and we've developed this. So Zach Ruff works in the lab. He has led up this effort to develop this PNWC net that we call. And I won't get into the details here, but just suffice to say that this has been critical for our ability to scale up and be able to monitor spotted owl populations range wide. We also have this study here. It was led by one of my PhD students, Kara Apple, and what she found is using acoustics, we could determine, distinguish between singles and pairs. And this is really important for population monitoring. And we're actually using this for a framework to monitor populations in the future. So I'm moving on here. and then we also, in this transition, we have this integrated study. It was led by another one of my PhD students, Matt Welding. And we're integrating the historical data, occupancy data, with the passive acoustics, and successfully resolve this spatial mismatch, which is a big challenge for us. But we've done this, and this is now providing us a framework as we're transitioning. So this is what I want everybody, I guess, maybe to walk away from, is that we now have a really powerful toolbox to monitor northern spotted owl populations completely passively. It's not requiring anything of us altering the behavior of spotted owls or doing any callback surveys, those sort of things. So we're coupling passive acoustics with artificial intelligence, forest inventory data, remote sensing, and then modern analytical methods. So this is, providing a really strong toolbox, and pretty powerful toolbox for us. And then, so we're continuing this work. We're going to do a meta-analysis, and we collected a lot of data in 2023. We've now implemented this 2+20% design, and we're going to have, a meta-analysis. And, so with that, I guess I'll do a couple of minutes over, and my apologies for that. I guess with that, I can take any questions. That was a pretty rapid fire.